All right, so we're here, the Digital Press Podcast team. It's Joe, Frankie, Greg, and Mike with Roger Hector from You Get It, and they are working on a, right now they have a Kickstarter project that's fairly just underway to do a project called Seriously, which is a combination iPad or iOS and card game, which sounds awesome. I'm going to let Roger take it from here. Roger, do you want to give us a little bit of your history? You have a very storied past. If you could, if there's any way you could briefly cover that for us.
Sure. I'll give you a brief brief rundown. I started working in games back in the mid-70s with Atari. I was really one of the first guys designing games. I was in the engineering group. I wound up moving into R&D and did a lot of creative stuff. We created a lot of prototypes and several production games. I worked with Al Alcorn, who is the other principal in You Get It right now. He was one of the founders of Atari and the guy that actually created Pong originally. So we've both had quite a lot of experience and have been around in games ever since then. So since my days at Atari, I was head of development with several large game companies. I ran the Sega Technical Institute, which was the division of Sega that produced the Sonic the Hedgehog games. I was an executive producer with Electronic Arts many years ago. Worked on the very first John Madden football game when it was on the Apple II. So that shows you how long ago it was. I was with Disney, Universal Studios. I'm trying to remember them all. With Valley, producing both the games and games, and sort of well over 100 game titles that I've had some involvement with producing one way or another, either being directly a part of the creative team or having, been more in the management level trying to get it done. But put a lot of games to the marketplace, and the last game company was with Namco Bandai, and worked on some more recent Pac-Man games, some PS3 and 360 titles, including Enslaved and Splatterhouse and things like that. So I've had a real variety of types and styles of game projects for quite a number of years.
So you never really put it away, right? You've been involved in the industry from the get-go, and this is a pretty exciting new project to us. As I understand the project, it reminds me a little bit of You Don't Know Jack, in that it's sort of a smart mouth kind of a announcer giving you the answers. But you play the game both with the iPad or iPhone and cards.
Yeah.
Can you walk through the game a little bit with us?
Well, the name of the game is Seriously, and you kind of hit some of the concept high points. It's basically a trivia game, but it's unlike really any trivia game that you might have seen before. You do utilize, there is a deck of cards that comes with the game, and the deck basically is used, the players draw the cards, and then they can read questions off of the card or place the card over the phone, which is generally sitting in the middle of the table of game players, and the card will be recognized by the phone, and you'll get possibly audio cues or even video clues or a snarky answer from our game host, who's actually quite funny.
And it sounds like
Our game host is has a bit of a resemblance to Siri.
A little bit.
But we're not utilizing Siri from a technical standpoint in Apple. We have a character, basically, that is similar personality, only a little bit snarkier.
Did the title of the game somewhat come from Siri? Because When I saw it seriously, I was wondering if that's kind of how you came up with it. Was that just me?
Well, actually, you're right. That was the very first time we spelled it out. I think we might have spelled it S-I-R-I, but at this point, we're using the more common spelling for our project because we're technically not connected to Apple at this point. But downstream, who knows?
So, Roger, I'm a big fan of irreverent trivia games. We do enjoy our You Don't Know Jacks and Buzz trivia on the PlayStation. But we also like physical card games, and most recently we've been enjoying games like Cards Against Humanity. And it's brought a lot of the classic gaming crowd here back to analog gaming. Was there a kind of a desire to meld the two with this, to bring the modern technology and the rise of the iOS app type games into the fold with the old classic analog hands-on stuff?
Well, you did hit it there. It is the case that a lot of people are familiar with sort of the classic trivia card game with questions and answers, but we want to do something different. We want to put a big twist on it, and by adding the kind of personality and trivia variety you can get through recorded audio and video that can be delivered through the phones, it elevates the whole game in a way that you really haven't experienced before. You can do a lot of stuff with video clips and with celebrity characters that jump in and say funny things, that you can really do quite a lot with that the old trivia card game just didn't do.
And with the possibilities for over-the-air updates and, you know, the whole App Store being able to push new content, I would expect that there's going to be future installments with maybe themed decks and stuff like that. Is that something you guys are thinking of?
You've got that exactly right. Our first deck is going to have a variety of sort of general interest questions and answers. It's all culture based, so we'll be hitting on a variety of themes within pop culture, from music to television to movies to TV or whatnot. So we're going to have a variety of things to work with, but in a different and very unique sort of way. And we will be updating the card decks with additional card decks later that will be probably themed. But one of the other things I didn't mention before was this game will have the ability to access questions that will be somewhat personalized and localized to you as a player, because we know through your phone basically where you are and a number of things that we can queue up to deliver more personal and custom relevant questions and things that will be somewhat surprising to you.
You make the paranoid people put their tinfoil hats on when the trivia game starts telling them where they've been in the past 24 hours.
Exactly. We do kind of want to freak you out a little bit with how amazingly perceptive our game show host is.
It strikes me as an evolution of a concept that existed back in, say, like the 80s and early 90s, when you had a board game that came with a VHS tape. And the videotape used to sort of engage you in your gameplay. So you'd be moving pieces around a board, but at the same time, the video would be giving you instructions and making commands of that nature. But here, it's sort of another step because of the fact that, unlike the VHS, this changes. This can be a little more, even more interactive.
Yeah, you're going to be surprised, actually, at some of the things that happen in the game. A number of people have done in the past, they've utilized things like VHS tapes and DVD discs and things that queue up some kind of trivia question or scenario of some sort. But ours is going to be much snappier. It's going to be very fast-paced and a little bit spontaneous and unpredictable. So that if if our game show host doesn't like your answers or how quickly you're answering, they're gonna, you know, she's gonna snap at you a little bit and try and get you, you know, try and get you back in line with playing the game. So you'll be surprised at how she behaves, and she is very fun.
Roger, I'm, as I look at the physical cards that are in the examples here, I don't see any kind of OCR patterns on them. What kind of magic does the software use to recognize what otherwise look like pretty plain cards to me?
Well, actually, that's part of what's going to be kind of fun about it. We're not using barcodes or obvious sort of traditional coding schemes. We have software that will recognize the image of the card. The card itself will be recognized and known by the from the game without having to use that kind of obvious device. So to the player, you just won't even be aware of the information flowing back and forth.
Well, that's cool. It makes it more aesthetically pleasing, too, not seeing a giant, you know, UPC or barcode on each card.
How do you have you done this Kickstarter thing before, and how do you feel about where it stands now?
Well, we haven't done it before. This is something that Al Alcorn and myself, we've been kicking around. We had this idea for this game, and we've seen several projects start to be very successful. Now, most of them are not, as you probably know, but of the ones that do. There have been quite a number of people that have successfully conducted a Kickstarter campaign, and we thought it would be fun to try. We just said, hey, let's give it a shot. Let's see how it goes. Now, we're only, we're about a week into it at this point, and there's three more weeks to go. At this point, we haven't unleashed all of the awareness, PR, social media that we've been building and have planned that's going to be getting more awareness out there. I think that basically is the secret to the Kickstarter project, is that you have to get a lot of awareness out there. I thank you guys for helping us out. Nothing wrong with that. We really appreciate it. But we have more things that are going to be coming out to build some more awareness for it.
Yeah, after this airs, you better brace yourself for the wave of contributions you're going to get, because we have an enormous
all 10 of our listeners.
Hey, both of those guys out there, jump in. I appreciate it.
No, we're pretty good at promoting things, so we'll do our best to make sure there's as much awareness to your product as possible. And obviously, you and Al are very close to our hearts. We're old school gamers, and we really want the project to succeed.
Hey, well, thank you very much. We really appreciate it. It's kind of a learning experience for us, and but we've been experimenters and creators really all of our lives. So this is the whole Kickstarter thing is an interesting project all in and of itself.
Yeah, I bet you wish you've had Kickstarter at other points in the past with projects, right? Could have come in handy.
It would have come in handy. I can think of a few dozen.
Yeah. All right, well, thank you. Do you guys have anything else that you want to...
Nope.
Anything just you want to add?
Best of luck.
Yeah, good luck.
Well, hey, look, thank you very much. We really appreciate it. And, if anybody wants to check out the Kickstarter project, there's going to be more stuff that's going to be showing up. Certainly on our site, we're going to be putting some more examples of the kinds of trivia that we're going to be doing out there. And I think it's pretty funny and entertaining. And so we'll be putting that out there, and you guys, take a look at it. And if anyone wants to jump in with us, we'll appreciate it greatly.
Okay, we'll be sure to include all of the links to your Kickstarter page. It's Seriously by You Get It, and thanks for being a part of this.
Excellent. Hey, thank you very much. We really appreciate it.
All right, take care. Welcome back. Our next segment is one that we hope we can do for every one of our podcasts going forward. This is kind of a fun sort of a thing. Fun finds. And specifically, with finds, us all as collectors have stories that we like to tell. Today's story is, what's one of the best finds that you've ever had, and where did you find it? So why don't we start all the way over there.
Oh, okay.
Yes, here we go. Go, Gabe, go.
Anywhere near the end.
I had too many to pick from just one,
But this is definitely one of my favorite ones. I found this at the flea market for $3, but it was only this half of the case and the game with it. So,
what is it?
It's a Suikoden for PS1.
How do you pronounce it?
I pronounce it Suikoden.
Like Sudoku?
Yeah.
Sudoku?
Sudoku? I was just reading an article about this the other day. There was a whole article. How do you pronounce the series? So what I did was I went and bought like Gran Turismo for like $2 at a playing trade, and I doubled up the case and I printed the artwork myself just so it looks nice and neat on my shelf.
I'm reporting you to Konami.
Yeah.
Woodstock paper.
This is going to be the reason this game doesn't get released on PSN. Because
it is.
Like, yeah. Well, then there you go. Yep. No one does.
You're waiting for Suikoden 2.
Do you use like a cardstock to make it look nice? Or something?
No, I use glossy photo paper. Yeah. And I have a photo printer at home. The most difference you can see in the quality is from in here. That's the only part you can really tell the difference.
So remember, kids, when you're looking through your used copies of Suikoden 2, watch out for Gabe's reprinted back art.
Now, see, I would almost be crazy enough that if I got that game, I would have to then find, like, a case that didn't have a game or just have it all authentic.
No, I just found
you
the game.
You are crazy.
That's insane.
Well, I just found a sports game. Nobody cares about those.
Well, it's the printing part that I wouldn't be bothered with.
Oh, well, no, I'm crazy like that. Another favorite find of mine, I managed to pick up almost the whole Dragon Warrior set. 1, 3, and 4 for $15 at a flea market. Dragon Warrior 3 is 100% complete. Dragon Warrior 1 is 100% complete. Dragon Warrior 4 is not. And I don't have the second one, which kind of drives me crazy.
What flea market is this?
These were all in New York.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, these were all in New York.
And not all at the same time. Yeah. All of those at the same time?
All of these at the same time. And Tetris was the only one that was a separate trip.
Are we talking, like, did you pay retail for these? Or were they someone who didn't know what they were worth?
Here's the funny thing. The guy that I bought it from is himself a collector, and he knows what this stuff is worth, but he still sells everything at flea market price. So he was like, $15.
Yeah.
Take the whole thing. I said, okay.
Oh.
I wasn't going to argue with that.
That's very good.
Yeah, so I haven't seen him in a while.
Was he one of those people that thought the world was going to end in 2012?
No.
Okay.
This was in 2012.
All right.
Maybe he was still just riding a high of, we're alive. There's a lot of money.
He didn't stuff any like religious pamphlets in there or something like that.
No, luckily I was able to avoid the religious pamphlet and no advertisements for the John Cusack movie.
The Dragon Warrior series is somewhat controversial among, you know, people. Like,
yeah.
You know, some people love it, some people hate it. You know, so what's your take on the series?
Well, I've only played, you know, parts of the first one. Years ago on Nintendo, and I'm a fan of classic JRPGs, so I'd probably get into it.
You don't mind grinding?
No,
doesn't get any more JRPGs than
grinding. Yeah, it doesn't.
I mean, grinding
doesn't bother me so much, you know, especially when you have nothing else to do, you know, because there are times
anything else to do is
exactly
better than grinding.
So, you know, if you need a time kill, there you go. Just go grind a few levels.
When I want a time killer, I play time killers.
Yeah. Well, there you go.
You.
On Genesis or arcade?
On main.
What, you don't like the Great Genesis version? And the same seller also hooked me up with a copy of Tengen Tetris, which everybody agrees is better than the official Nintendo version.
I'm sure there's one guy that doesn't agree.
Yeah.
And he's going to write us as soon as he hears it.
You don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah. We're going to lose one of our four viewers.
Sorry, guy. Okay, I'm sorry. You're
Russian
right.
Tetris.
Same seller also hooked me up with Lolo 1, 2, and 3. And Lolo 2 did come with the manual, which is really cool. And Lolo 3 is in the box.
Dude, I need the box for Lolo 3.
Well, you're not getting this
one. Yeah, you're out of here with
trade
that.
Here.
You're not getting this one.
Can I just say one thing about Lolo real fast?
Go ahead.
When I was in fifth grade back then, my teacher, who was very, very conservative about what she let her kids, games she let her kids play, she probably, for all I know, she probably bought them the Wisdom Tree games. But she actually like would come in and tell the class at how much she loved the Adventures of Lolo because it was so kid friendly.
Like,
so we immediately hated it.
The least offensive.
Is it bothering
ever.
You that Lolo is on our table right now?
No, well I can't see it.
Okay, I'll just
all right, let's
keep
upsetting me.
And my one online find. This one, my one online find, on shopgoodwill.com, Spider-Man Web of Fire, which is probably the most expensive game on 32X, at least from America. This game alone usually goes for $200 I've seen on eBay. I snagged this on goodwill.com with a Genesis 32X and a lot of other games for around the same price. So it was a lot of money, but I got a massive amount of things with it. So, I mean, the way I looked at it was, $200, and I just happened to get Spider-Man with it. That was the logic at the time. And I figured, oh, maybe it's a decent game. It's not a decent game.
Not good.
It is not a decent game.
It's when he had urinary tract infection, right? The Web of Fire?
Yeah. Well, you can see it there, like, all behind him. That was... that was the aftermath.
Yeah. Is that all? That's how you brought your entire collection?
Giant thing next to you.
This thing?
What did you bring, Mike?
All right, well...
Wonder Smegma?
Stop. I'm the only one able to make... gross jokes here, okay? This is a Wonder Mega.
Ah.
It's effectively a Japanese XI. This is an interesting story because I didn't know what it was when I bought it. It's,
But you honestly didn't know what it was?
I had no idea what it was. Because, because this thing was...
like, fuck it, let's spend a lot of money.
And Google was broken the day he saw it.
Well, it was one of the... Okay, here's the situation. This is a Genesis and Sega CD combination machine and does karaoke and everything like that. When I saw it, I got this on eBay. This is around, 2009. I was just randomly... This is one of those right place to right time things. I was just randomly browsing Sega CD. I just put Sega CD in the search bar and I was just scrolling through. And an auction had just come up. It must have been running for about 8 minutes. So it was just put up. And there was this picture of this thing. It said Wonder Mega, Sega branded. And it said, the auction was, it said something like Sega CD Wonder Mega machine. Like it was like really like, I don't even think the person selling it really knew what it was. So I'm looking at it. It was $30, $15 shipping, and I'm looking at it. About a minute goes by, and am I gonna spend, am I gonna spend $45 on something I don't know what it is? I'm like, you know what? I'll spend $45 on something I don't know what it is. Worst case scenario, I can, maybe make half my money back if I'm gonna sell it for, to some other schmuck other than me. who's gonna buy something who doesn't know
this
what it is?
Was a buy it now or an auction?
It was a buy it now.
Okay.
And so I hit the buy it now, and after I bought it is when I started Googling it, because I do things backwards because that's how I am.
Yeah, right.
So Joe, what's this worth approximately, you think?
In that condition in the box, $250.
All right,
there you go. Yeah. And I noticed one of the cool things that I noticed about it actually has built-in S video.
Yeah, it does.
You don't have to mod it.
I'll tell you, when I first plugged it in, and it does
stylish.
It does a lot of audio things. Like, it doesn't sound like a normal Genesis.
Right.
It actually sounds nice. It's got like a lot of bass. It's like really it sounds strong.
And it looks a lot nicer than the XI. In my opinion.
Yeah,
the XI
it does
is a pretty boring looking machine.
Well,
that's a nice looking machine.
If that has karaoke functionality, it probably has really good sound hardware in it.
Yeah, no, it's and the S video looks gorgeous.
Yeah.
What I find most fun about the machine, honestly, is the CD, the way the CD opens.
How does it open?
You have to go into the, it's not mechanical.
Oh, it's electronic?
You have to go in, the BIOS,
right.
And you click CD open, and it slowly loads up.
So what's the failure rate on Wonder Mega CD open?
But it's neat, because you hit the button, it opens up, then you hit it again, and it closes by itself.
Ah,
so it's, wow. So it's like, I'm sitting there going, open, close, open, close.
Yeah, exactly. 80%
Before I even played a game on the thing, I'm like, open, close.
I've got to believe that.
It's open, close.
A good 90% of the
CD drive goes up. CD drive goes up.
Exactly. That's exactly what it was. And then I'm like, okay, maybe I should stop doing this, because I'm going to burn out the motor.
So all of this hardware, is pretty much proprietary at the point that Wonder Mega was developed. So you know 90% of the engineering went into that feature.
Probably, like,
just the motor.
I've never seen that before, an open shut top loader like that.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. Very neat.
Yeah.
It's one of those cases of a really badly worded eBay listing.
Yeah, it's just, I mean, that was the right place at the right time. That's all it was. You know.
Alrighty. Greg came empty-handed, so let me jump in. So, I've been collecting a long, long time, and I have now the unique advantage of having a store where things come in instead of me having to go out. I don't miss those days of hunting at all. So in this particular case, I have three Nintendo 64 controllers, all of which came in to the store at some point. Now, two of them aren't very interesting stories because they came from collectors. So these collectors pretty much knew what they had when they sold them to me. One was at a Navo where I got this Millennium 2000. These are all Nintendo Power type.
Mailaways.
Yeah, they were all limited availability, never sold in stores, and available through various Nintendo Power types of giveaways.
Like
in fact, especially has Nintendo Power emblazoned on it. So one of them I got from a customer that knew what he had, and one of them I got at a Navo meeting for a good price. The Millennium 2000, I think I got for $50, which probably sounds like a lot of money for a controller, but good luck trying to find another one. I mean, I've been on eBay looking to see what it's actually worth, and I'm having a hard time because I just don't see them out there. Now, after I had acquired these two, my friend Sean Kelly tells me, oh, what do you mean? You don't have the third one, the rare Donkey Kong, the Donkey Kong Country controller. I'm like, you know what? I don't think I've ever seen that one. So I have it in a search, and I've seen, now I know what it looks like. Months go by, it's just never at a price that I want to pay for it. And sure enough, somebody comes in on a Navo. I think it might have even been Gabe. It was either you or it might have been Mickey, but it was somebody at a NAVA meeting who was in the basement, and they come upstairs and they're like, did you know you had this yellow controller sitting in your controller box downstairs? I'm like, no. So basically somebody took it in on a trade-in thinking it was just a plain old yellow controller. But as you can see, with other than the Donkey Kong 64 on it, it's actually got these banana sort of looking edges on it. It's supposed to look like bananas.
And then I said to you, hey, you got to clean that controller
off. That's all that dirty schmutz on it.
So then Joe got a Brillo pad and immediately started scouring off the printed
design. So this one found its way into my hands probably for $1. I mean, whatever we paid for a regular Nintendo controller. Unfortunately, I don't know who the customer was. I don't exactly even know when it came in. But it had been sitting in an overstock pile with controllers. And unfortunately, one of our Navi guys found it. So that was kind of a fun find to me.
That's bananas.
That is bananas.
You know what I like most, too, about this Millennium 2000? I think that's one of the only controllers where the button colors aren't the standard yellow, green, and blue.
It is the only one, I believe.
That is
buttons
that's
are
my
black.
Favorite of the three. Yeah. I think that's really cool.
It doesn't
we got a caller.
We got a caller.
We have a live caller.
Someone's upset. You got that for me.
Okay. All right, here we go. Hello, caller. You are on with the Digital Press Podcast. How can we help you?
Yes, how are you? Do you have any GameCube memory cards or Wii memory cards?
Is there any particular size of memory card that you're interested in?
Yes.
Or color?
251 blocks or more.
The 251, the rare 251 block card.
I'm sorry, say it again?
Yeah, I think we do. We have that's the white card, right?
Yeah, can I use that for GameCube?
Yes, it'll work on GameCube or Wii.
How much is it?
That is a $30 item.
Okay, no problem. Thank you.
You're welcome. Have a good day.
Always happy to help.
Yes.
On the Digital Press Podcast.
For service.
That guy's voice will now live on in infamy.
To
thank
all
you,
three
random,
people.
Thank you, random GameCube memory card hunter.
So, Frankie, you bring something?
Yes. 3 years ago, roughly, my wife and I purchased a condominium in Fort Lee, and sometime within my first 3 months of living there, I was taking the dog out for the morning walk, and there happens to be an on-site dumpster where all of the trash from the condominium is placed for the garbage men. And as I was coming back in, I saw a very familiar gold fleck sticking out from a box inside of the garbage can, and any classic gamer would recognize the gold coloration of the Legend of Zelda cartridge from the original Nintendo. So I said, oh, hey, I know what that is. And as I opened the box, I found someone's childhood in the garbage can. So I'm not going to go through every single game, but this was what I found in the garbage. And I estimate, based on the condition of these, based on the sprawl of titles, and based on the frequency of no-lock tabs that occur on some of these, you'll see that they have the original no-slotted tabs in there. I believe that this was probably someone's personal collection who owned a Nintendo, who purchased all these games, never got into the act of buying or selling used because the conditions are all identical. And they just look like they were handled nicely. None of them have any kind of corrosion on the inside. You know, I'd say the winner, if I had to pick one cartridge of value in here, is probably Bubble Bobble. The rest of them are all relatively common, but...
And this is the entire lot of things that you found in there?
I've kept them separated from my rest of my collection because I like to be able to pull them out and say, this specific lot of games I found in the garbage at my condo complex, and, you know, I was good enough to rescue them from decimation.
What would you say the value of the overall collection is? Did you ever think it through?
I don't know, maybe 100. Yeah. Eyeballing.
I see a few $20 games here, like a Tyson and Mega Man.
I will say, though, I see DuckTales. I've never come across DuckTales in a while.
Yeah.
Really?
In all my flea
Has it become
trips?
A...
People keep that?
Yeah. It's a Bubble Bobble level type game, so it's...
I've got, you know, like the no-lock tab games. I've got a Hogan's Alley, a Super Mario with no-lock, a Castlevania with no-lock, which... That's I don't see this one with a no-lock.
Really good titles.
Yeah.
When he announced it several years ago...
I made a thread on the forums.
Dumpster diving.
I was surprised.
That couldn't have gone well.
It was one of the more well-received in my personal history.
That was probably another guy who just got married, and that was his
This. And if it wasn't for this one with the reflective qualities, I might never have spotted them. But this... Happens to be about good condition Zelda.
Yeah, that's a really good shape.
Well, what amazed us collectively was that whoever this person, what they literally didn't have any cruddy like crappos.
Yeah.
You know, like even when I was a kid, we bought games that stunk. We didn't realize it until
Nicholas Golf.
Right.
Where's Fester's Quest? Yes. How was that
City
not
Connection?
Maybe they did. You know, get into selling, and they only sold off the garbage and kept their personal favorites, but. I still feel like this to me feels like emotionally a collection from somebody who was a smart buyer back in the day. You know, Mario 1, 2, and 3, Mega Man 1 and 2.
It's good stuff.
And then 3 years later, I found a Wii, a perfect condition Wii, thrown out minus the Wiimotes. So I have to believe that's probably somebody... A family situation, and based on the save files on it, it was a lot of kids' games. So it was probably a family that upgraded to a Wii U and kept the Wiimotes. And they
same dumpster.
But they placed it very carefully along with like a VCR and an old DVD player.
Yeah.
No kind of upscaling or high definition. So they probably were saying like, someone should probably take these before the trash comes.
It's that same guy.
And it was me. I rescued the Wii. It's also. In my
now
collection.
Greg is going to announce it was him all along,
and he wants them back.
I do have this reminds me of a similar story I have from many years ago. My grandparents lived in a condo, a smaller condo complex, and in the basement of one of the buildings was like a storage area. So like each person would have like a small cage, in this basement where I guess you could put. Stuff.
We have one of those in our condo, and there's a lifetime waiting list to get in there. Like, really? There's not enough spaces for the units, so it's only when people die that you get an opportunity.
All right, so this place, they had it there, and I forget, one day I had to go down there with my grandmother to get stuff and carry, maybe like folding chairs, carry it back or something, and I was probably like 10, so it was late 80s, and... I remember I went down there, and there was the cages were all on the outside, so in the middle was, like, the junk area. Like, if you didn't want anything, you just left it there, and then whoever the maintenance person was would throw it in the garbage. And right there was a box with a ColecoVision and, like, a whole ton of games and everything like that, and I wanted it. I wanted to take it, and my grandmother was like, well, I don't know if someone's throwing that out or not, but I'm like, it's in the garbage pile. And she would not let me take it. And that's actually one of the things that has spurred me along in the collecting hobby to this day is
now you go in every dumpster you see
of not getting it.
That's definitely going to be a topic for the
one of that collecting
is perfectly good medical waste
because we all have stories about what we missed over the years, so we'll definitely make that a feature in the future.
Well, the other problem was I couldn't prove to her or my mother when she came to pick me up that day that it would work. Because that was one of the things back then was we had 2600s and Atari computers and like something would break. Normally the AC adapter would break or something and then they would make me like throw it out. Because they're like, well, I'm not buying it. This thing's going to keep breaking on you. I'm not buying another whatever. And so that was one of the reasons they wouldn't let me take it.
Ah, the logic of parents. Mm-hmm.
It's good to be an adult now, isn't it?
Yes.
I'll decide.
That's like, you know, your spark plug dies in a car. All right, I guess I got to get a new car. I'm not going to replace that spark plug.
And with that analogy, I think we're done.
And we're back on the Digital Press podcast, and we are here with Martin Touhey from Sleepy Eyed Films, who is the director and writer of the upcoming documentary Inside the Dragon's Lair. How you doing, Martin?
Good. How are you guys doing?
Great. I'm a huge Dragon's Lair fan, and the guys know me as the Dragon's Lair aficionado of the group, and I wanted to have you talk to us today about your project and what it's been like getting this rolling. What has the fan reaction been like to a documentary all about Dragon's Lair?
The fans of Dragon's Lair have been absolutely great. They're all behind it, and everybody's really looking forward to it, myself included. This has been a labor of love for the past about 4.5 years, so you know it's taken a while, but we're finally on track to getting something out there, and we're going to be launching a Kickstarter campaign soon, so people can pre-order the movie, and hopefully we'll be able to release sometime about April or May of 2014. We're thinking.
That sounds great. What is the fans? I mean, has there been any kind of division? I know Dragon's Lair is a bit of a divisive property, and it always has been. The game is one of those love it or hate it situations, I find, for most people anyway. Have you found that in your talking to fans, just classic gamers in general?
Yeah, absolutely. It's kind of strange. Dragon's Lair is one of the most polarizing games when it comes to gamers. Some people love it. The people that do love it, usually it's because of nostalgia. Some people actually do enjoy the gameplay. I personally love Dragon's Lair for both those aspects. For me, it's mostly the nostalgia and the beautiful animation by Don Bluth. Also, on the flip side of it, most gamers that don't like the game, they usually complain about the quick time event style of gameplay and how it's basically a linear game, and they don't like just having to choose, you know, one, you know, if you move in one direction, you're safe, and if you move in any other direction, you're not safe, and you die. So it really, even back in the 80s when it first came out, it was a big quarter eater. People complained about it being, you know, 50 cents, and they died almost instantly in the first few screens.
Well, and a valid complaint. I'm sure that, you know, when Gary Goldman and Rick Dyer came up with the kind of mechanics of that, they knew that was one of the big appeal for the coin-op business is that they were guaranteeing an influx of money. It's not something that you can guess, and it's not something that you can learn through anything other than repetition and learning.
Right. Yeah, the rote memorization is probably the biggest complaint among gamers. But I mean, let's think about this also in terms of like Donkey Kong or even Pac-Man. Like Pac-Man, you have to memorize certain patterns in order to get through the game perfectly. To play Donkey Kong, sometimes memorization of those. Well, actually, Donkey Kong is a little more random, so maybe that's a bad example. But I mean, there are other games out there similar that you do have to memorize things. So, you know, I guess that's you know, my small defense of it.
Yeah, at least the the champion level players will probably say that there is a lot of, you know, memorization via the limitations.
Yeah, that's how
that's
how they get through it. Dragon's Lair is just not subtle about it.
There's so many games that people are that are almost universally loved that are, you know, about a lot of have a lot of around memorization. A game like Punch Out, for instance. And even modern games, I think that Dragon's Lair is effectively the progenitor of, you know, something like Heavy Rain.
Actually, there's a lot of games that do contain a lot of quick time events, and Dragon's Lair did pioneer the quick time event. And if it weren't for that, maybe possibly these style that style of gameplay might not have existed until maybe a later time or even at all, you know.
But it also pioneered the idea that games could be cinematic in a way. I mean, I can't think of many games from the, you know, from the 80s that really pushed the idea that you were playing through, you had control over some kind of narrative, you know, and some kind of, you know, and I mean, Don Bluth in the 80s was king. I mean, you know, you had, you know, Land Before Time, All Those Go to Heaven and everything like that. And so to have, you know, Dirk wandering through this castle and in a way, in you can, even when you're dying, that's still sort of a narrative completion. You're still seeing something play out. You do have an ending. And in some ways, dying is more fun than succeeding because of how amusing the deaths can be.
How many ways can
that's
I?
That's pretty dark, Mike. Yeah.
Well, I know.
It's always more fun than winning.
Well, no, is there something you want to talk about?
Well, I mean, in terms of the quarter-eating nature of the game.
The deaths were really the most enjoyable part of the game. And in a way, I think it was kind of that kind of thing that kept players coming back to it, because it was like, well, completing the game, it's satisfying that you get to save Daphne, but the most of the people that I know who love the game and me personally, it's all about the deaths and how he dies, and it's the comedy that really makes Dragon's Lair shine in that.
I personally laugh every time during the one death where he gets covered in that goo. He's like,
yes,
you know, I love that one.
And you know, I think Don Bluth voiced a couple of Dirk's high pitched screams.
Actually, Don Bluth did not do that. The voice of Dirk was Dan Molina, was the editor actually on the game. And the only reason that they used him was because they couldn't afford voice actors at the time. They had a very low budget, and they basically used people around them for the voice of Dirk, and also the voice of Daphne was, I believe, an assistant animator, Vera Pacheco. At the time, her name was Vera Lanfer. So, I mean, their budget was so low, they couldn't even hire voice actors for it, so they used what they had.
Now, did they try and snag union cards based on their experience with Dragon's Lair? The Voice Actors Guild?
Well, I mean, they probably could have at that point in time, and who knows if they did, if they've kept up with their dues all the way up to the 30th anniversary. We are in the 30th anniversary Dragon's Lair now.
Yeah, 30 years. I was hoping to have the movie released for the 30th anniversary, but of course, you know, in any independent production, whether it's movies, games, whatever, it usually takes a lot longer than you anticipate. So.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, speaking of the gruesome death sequences in Dragon's Lair, very impressionable to a six-year-old in a Chuck E. Cheese. My first experience with Dragon's Lair, walking in and seeing that alongside Pac-Man and Donkey Kong, but I kind of reflect on those extreme death sequences, even though there's no blood. When I saw news reports on gaming forums and blogs about the recent Tomb Raider release and how Lara Croft got spikes through her head or crushed under rocks, I said, you know what? Mm-hmm. If you played Dragon's Lair as a kid, none of that should be that shocking to you, because you've seen
stabbed.
You've seen spikes and swords and all kind manner of
acidic drinks.
It's actually funny. There's one part in Dragon's Lair where Dirk gets stabbed in the back, and believe it or not, they actually edited that back in the 80s, because there's a couple frames in the game where you could actually see the knife sticking out of his back, and they actually took the knife out because they didn't want it to be quote unquote too violent. But Dragon's Lair is a completely violent game anyway, and
I think you're comparing apples and oranges.
Considering what Don Bluth was doing in the 80s, that was too violent.
Yeah. Like, he could get stabbed, and no one could see that he actually had a knife inside of him.
I mean,
yeah, that's nice.
Didn't Secret of Nim have a knife in the back?
Yep. Yep, even the same kind, the wavy blade. Now, Martin, you...
Same knife.
I know that in the film that you do speak with the people who are responsible for the Dragon's Lair project, and what are your experiences with their passion and drive to bring essentially the first, they were the people who really looked at all of the home versions of Dragon's Lair and said, you know, we have the technology, and yet the people who own the commercial license just don't seem to be able to get this right. Let's reverse engineer the actual hardware and make our computers talk and think and do what the original machines do. What did they have to say about what their vision was?
Well, I guess, I mean, back in the 80s when Dragon's Lair first came out, obviously technology could not keep up with the slow motion video aspect of it. As technology got better around, I'd say, I believe like 92, 93, that's when you started seeing really more arcade-accurate versions come out. I do have a future interview with David Foster, who is the head of Digital Leisure, who has released the DVD versions, the Blu-ray versions of Dragon's Lair, and he's been with the Dragon's Lair property ever since, I believe, the ReadySoft versions, which were back in the 80s, when they were just starting to, where the technology was just starting to get there, where they could kind of almost emulate the full motion video. He's been dedicated to Dragon's Lair, you know, for years and years and years. And I haven't actually spoken to him as of yet. I've talked to him online a couple times, and he just loves the game like all the Dragon's Lair fans do. As far as anybody else who has worked on those games, I have not actually spoken to anybody else in that regard.
Oh, okay. Have you you aware of the Daphne project? The guys who did the
Daphne emulator. Yeah, I actually spoke to and interviewed Warren Andres, who he did mostly like graphical user interface design and things like that. He did minor things on the project. Matt Ownby, who headed the Daphne project, I've been in contact with him through email a few times, and he is on our list of future interviewees. So he should be a very interesting person to interview. Also, Dave Halleck, who is a administrator at the DragonsLairProject.com, he's the one who is actually responsible for reverse engineering the actual ROM chips in the arcade game and actually making it so that the movements and everything like that for the game are as accurate as possible for the Daphne emulator. So he is also going to be an interview for the film.
Excellent. Yeah, the Daphne emulator, we've all had some hands-on experience with it. I mean, I've run it. I know it's kind of inside baseball, but I know that some of the you know, arcade museums and places like Fun Spot have transitioned over from using the Laserdisc hardware because it's so simply too fragile at this point in time, and Daphne is so accurate that to the naked eye, it's almost impossible to tell the difference, so... They've made some great legway there for the preservation of Dragon's Lair as an active arcade machine.
Yeah, that's true, and it's very, very rare to find a actual Dragon's Lair working machine that has the original Laserdisc in it out there in the wild at an arcade. It's nearly impossible. I believe they have one at Hershey Park in Pennsylvania. That's the only one that I actually know of that has the original Laserdisc. But like you said, Fun Spot, they run the Daphne emulator. I'm talking to Gary Vincent over there, I believe he's a floor manager there over at Fun Spot. We're going to be talking to him about that. And his take on Dragon's Lair when it first came out in the arcade, and it's going to be interesting to see his viewpoint on that.
You guys have any thoughts on Dragon's Lair?
Not so much the game, but more, I guess, towards the movie. Dragon's Lair, obviously, was a big hit when it came out. Personally, and this is nothing against the game, more the movie, I feel like it may not have the kind of name association that a lot of other classic arcade games do. Is that something you're kind of worried about with the release of Inside the Dragon's Lair?
So as far as, like, its recognition, you mean?
Yes.
Not really. I mean, Dragon's Lair has a pretty strong fan base, having that large fan base is going to be significant in the success of the movie. We're going to be obviously running, like I said before, running a Kickstarter, and that's really going to be the telltale sign of how popular it is at this moment. Now, for me personally, the challenge is going to be not only getting the Dragon's Lair fans to kind of donate money to this, but also like the casual viewer who doesn't know anything about Dragon's Lair, and it's going to be a trick to kind of hook them to want to donate to the project. And that's basically me and my producer's job, is to make the best trailer possible, the best product possible, so that people will respond to it positively. And you know, that like any other movie in the world, it's just a matter of being able to make the best product available.
Well, there certainly have been some entertaining documentaries about the history of classic gaming in recent years. I mean, starting with something like King of Kong, and then Chasing Ghosts, and even Special When Lit, the great pinball documentary that was... I mean, those are things that are giving relevance, I think, to opening up an audience to say, hey, look at the history of this. This is significant. So I think Dragon's Lair is... To some people, it's an anomaly, but to others, it's so pervasive. It has managed to maintain an iconic status alongside games like Pac-Man and Donkey Kong and Space Invaders, and you know, it maintains. People want it. People want it. They keep making home versions, and we're at a point right now where the home versions are so perfect and so high definition. All they literally need to do is roll them into compatibility with whatever the next gen. They can release Dragon's Lair on PlayStation 4 and Xbox One and whatever the next thing is, and it's pretty much perfect at this point. They've figured it all out.
Yeah, all the kinks really have been worked out as far as that goes. And also, the movie is not just singularly about the game Dragon's Lair. It's more about the story behind it, how it was created, and basically how Dragon's Lair really was the catalyst for Don Bluth to create more animated films, because Secret of Nim, his first animated film, his first solo project, was a financial failure. It had critical acclaim, but it was financially a flop, because at the time, they went up against E.T., which was a huge blockbuster. Now, Dragon's Lair kind of came in when they were in the downtime of basically doing nothing after the flop of Nim, and they really didn't know what they were going to do next. Rick Dyer comes knocking on their door, and he's like, hey, I have this great idea for a game, and I'd love you to animate it. And at the same time, there was actually a animation union strike. So nobody could actually do any animation for film or television at the time without being booted from the union. So, at the time, it was feast or famine for them, kind of a thing. And then Dragon's Lair shows up. There was nothing in the contracts that said that they couldn't work on a video game, so they kind of lucked out in that situation. That actually gave them the work to keep on going, keep Don Bluth's productions going. And if it weren't for Dragon's Lair, maybe we wouldn't have, you know, Land Before Time or All Dogs Go to Heaven or anything like that. Maybe they would have gone belly up, you know.
Fantastic. Well, Gabe, did you have any thoughts or questions? Well, that sounds like this is going to be a really all-encompassing feature about Dragon's Lair, about Don Bluth and Gary Goldman and Rick Dyer and John Pomeroy and everybody who put their heart and souls into it, and how it affected classic arcade scene and how it remains a prevalent and iconic title till today. Thanks for calling in. We're going to make sure that we have all of the links to the Inside the Dragon's Lair Facebook page and the website. And did you have anything else you wanted to say to the classic gamers who listen to the Digital Press podcast?
Thanks for listening, and we're looking forward to releasing the film. We just hope that everybody enjoys it. You know, spread the word and let everybody know. One thing I have found interesting is that on Twitter, like I do searches for Dragon's Lair through my tweet deck all the time, so it's kind of like one of my columns. And one of the most interesting things I've found is that even though there are a lot of Dragon's Lair haters out there, like every now and then I'll engage a few of them and I'll give them the link to the trailer and they get excited about watching the movie even though they hate the game. And I think that's kind of like, I think that's a great telling sign that this movie can span across the haters also. It's not just for Dragon's Lair fans, it's for everybody. So even if you hate the game, I'm sure you would be able to enjoy the movie as well. So,
all right. Well, best of luck, Martin.
All right. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Take it easy.
Bye-bye.
Okay. Bye.
Don't stop. Behind that TV, there's something I want to give Frankie. See it?
This here?
Yes.
Boom, 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 boom.
The big reveal.
Uh-huh. Oh, nice. It completes my collection of Don Bluth Laserdiscs, Dragon's Lair 2. Oh, thank you.
I saw that you had the first game in Space Ace, like,
yes.
In really nice frames.
Yeah.
And you said, I don't have the second one, but I'm really planning on getting it today. So I saw it, I'm like, I have, the only one I have is 2. I'm just sitting in that sleeve for years. I'm like, somebody will appreciate it.
Oh, thanks.
That's very cool.
Thanks, Jeff.
Collection complete.
Yes. There you go.